clearly visible audible to you people? Let me confirm it. Just a second. Let me confirm if I'm clearly visible audible. I will start it. Okay. So give me a thumbs up in the chat box if I'm clearly visible and audible to you people. Okay, so I hope I'm clearly visible to you. I welcome you all for this session. A very good morning to all of you. I'm Dr. Priyanka Sachdev here, and today I'm here to teach you drugs for respiratory system. Especially, I will teach you drugs for asthma. Drugs for asthma. So I will start with respiratory system. Now, okay, just a second. So you will have a better understanding if you understand the pathophysiology of asthma. If you understand how asthma is happening, that is type 1 hypersensitivity, the various steps in the occurrence, in the pathogenesis of the asthma, it will be easy for you to understand the mechanism of action of various drugs at what level they are acting to prevent and to treat asthma. Some drugs are for prevention of asthma, and some drugs are for the prevention of the attacks, or for the recurrence of asthma attacks, and some are for treatment. So some are for prophylaxis, some are for treatment. So you will have a better understanding. So just in the first 2 or 3 minutes, I will teach you the pathophysiology of asthma. Immediately after that, I will come on the drugs for asthma. So let's see, you already know what is asthenous in the lung. So in the lung, there is trachea. You can see there is trachea. The trachea divides into the two bronchi, left and right, the two bronchi. Trachea divides into the bronchi. Bronchi starts dividing into bronchioles. So first primary bronchioles, then secondary bronchioles, tertiary bronchioles. So bronchioles, primary, secondary, tertiary, then terminal bronchioles. Last is terminal, then respiratory bronchioles. After that, there is respiratory bronchiole. From respiratory bronchioles, alveolar duct arises, then alveolar sac arises. So last three structures here. Which last three structures? I am talking about these three structures. So respiratory bronchiole, alveolar duct and alveolar sac. These three structures together known as acinus. So acinus is the structural and functional unit of the lung. We already know it. So each lung contains nearly 1 million of acinus. You can see this is acinus. You can see this is respiratory bronchiole. From each respiratory bronchiole, various, let me take another color, multiple alveolar ducts are arising. These all are alveolar ducts. And from multiple alveolar ducts, various alveolar sacs are arising. These are alveolar sacs. So this structure is known as acinus. So you can see this is the acinus here. Respiratory bronchiole, alveolar duct, alveolar sac. You can see from one alveolar duct, respiratory bronchiole, multiple alveolar ducts are arising. From each alveolar duct, multiple alveolar sacs are arising. So you can see this is acinus. You can see this is acinus. The last three structures, respiratory bronchiole, alveolar duct and alveolar sac. Why I am telling you this with so much stress? Okay, what is asthma? Let me come. Now each lung, each human have a pair of lung, right and left lung. Each lung contains nearly 300 million of acinus. 300 million of acinus are there average in lung. Now there are 4 layers in the trachea. That is mucosa, submucosa, muscularis propria and serosa. You know the 4 layers, right? Of the trachea, of the bronchi, the 4 layers are there. The first layer is mucosa, then submucosa, then muscularis propria and then serosa. Submucosa contains glands. Submucosa contains glands. So you can see the 4 layers. This is mucosa. Mucosa is pseudostratified ciliated columnar epithelia. Then this is submucosa. Can you see? Submucosa contains glands. The glands do the secretion. You should understand it for understanding asthma and for understanding the drugs for the asthma. Then there is muscularis propria containing the cartilage, and then there is serosa. So these are the 4 layers. 4 layers. After 4 layers, you should understand the COPDs. Now there are 5 types of COPDs. Chronic bronchitis, emphysema, asthma, bronchiectasis and bronchiolitis. In pathology, I taught you all 5. In pathology, I have covered all 5. Those who have missed pathology lecture, they must watch the recording. It is available free. You can watch it anytime. Currently, I will teach you only asthma, not all COPDs. There are 5 types of COPDs. You should know the comparison between them. I'm starting with asthma. So you should know pathophysiology of asthma to understand the drugs for asthma. Now, what is asthma? What is asthma? I can't directly jump on the drugs of asthma. First, you should understand what is asthma, and how it occurs. How it occurs, if you know, so you will be able to understand the various steps at which we can use the drugs to prevent it and the mechanism how which we can treat it. So what is asthma? What is asthma? Now listen, asthma is the disease of trachea and bronchi. It is a disease of trachea and bronchi. It is not a disease of acinus. It is a disease at this level, trachea and bronchi. So trachea and bronchi, just suppose a pollen grain is going inside me. I am the person. it is going inside. I'm inhaling out pollen grain or some allergen or dust particle. It is going inside the nose. It is going inside the nose. From the nose, it will go in the larynx, in the pharynx, then it will go in the trachea. In the trachea, from the trachea, it will go to the bronchi, right? It will go to the bronchi. So trachea and bronchi, it is going. So what will happen if I'm a normal human being? What will happen? So there is cilia. There is cilia in the lining, pseudostratified ciliated columnar epithelia. The lining is pseudostratified ciliated. Cilia is present in the lining. So cilia will beat and try to remove this allergen out of the body with the help of cilia, with the help of hairs in the nose. The nose of our noses have hairs. So with the help of hairs, we will try to trap the allergen there only and try to prevent the allergen entry inside. But still, agar usse bhi nahi ruka, cilia ki beating se bhi nahi ruka and allergen is going inside. So there are macrophages that will engulf the allergen. It's okay. So that is the thing. So these are the various defense mechanism in normal human beings. But some persons are hypersensitive. What do you mean by hypersensitive? As soon as, just suppose I am the patient. I'm having asthma. So my trachea and my bronchi are hypersensitive. As soon as any allergen, this is allergen. It is going inside my respiratory tract. The allergen entering the trachea and the bronchi, the trachea and the two bronchi undergo spasm. They undergo spasm, bronchoconstriction or spasm, one and the same thing. They undergo bronchoconstriction. So the lumen is narrowed. The body is trying to prevent the entry of the allergen into the body. So as a part of defense mechanism, body is doing so. So allergen will not enter. So aap bologi, ma'am, ye toh achhi baat hai na. This is a good thing. Allergen will not enter, but air will also not enter. How the air will go? If I will inhale, how air will go inside? Because the person is in bronchoconstriction or spasm. That is the attack of asthma. During the attack of asthma, there is bronchoconstriction or spasm. The bronchi, the trachea and the bronchi undergo spasm or they undergo bronchoconstriction. So patient can't breathe. That is the attack of asthma. After few minutes, spontaneously bronchodilation takes place either or with therapy, with treatment. If you use the pumps, asthma patients already keep pumps in their pockets, right? They always keep pumps with them in their purse, in their pocket. So if they do the pumping, if they apply the pump, then bronchodilation takes place. That means that bronchoconstriction is not permanent. It is relieved either spontaneously or by treatment or by therapy. See the bronchi here. Okay, I will mark it for you. See bronchial lumen here. It is a normal person. See the bronchial lumen here. This is asthma person. Now compare the two. Allergen is going inside here also. Allergen is going inside here also. So here on entering of allergen, nothing is happening much. But here on entering the allergen, bronchoconstriction taking place. So these persons are hypersensitive. Give me a thumbs up. Have you got it? Now compare here also. Compare this lumen and compare this lumen. This is normal and this is asthma. Give me a thumbs up. So that is the thing. So it is increased responsiveness or hypersensitivity of trachea and bronchi to a variety of stimulus. Can be pollen grain, stimulus can be dust, stimulus can be anything, which is leading to spasmodic narrowing of the air passage. The air passage is undergoing spasmodic narrowing, but not permanently for always. It will relieve spontaneously or by therapy. Done. That is temporary. Give me a thumbs up. That's why asthma comes in attacks. So one attack is coming, then second attack is coming. Between the two attacks, patient is normal. So patient is having no symptoms between the two attacks, but when the pollen grain is entering, at that time bronchospasm takes place for few minutes. After that, it is relieved either spontaneously or by therapy. Done. Give me a thumbs up. So asthma is not a constant disease. If some person is having asthma, it is not the thing he is having dyspnea, na? He will have dyspnea. He will not have dyspnea permanently. He will have dyspnea between the two attacks of the dyspnea. He is absolutely normal. So asthma occurs in attacks. Attacks means paroxysm. Asthma is a paroxysmal disease. Have you got it? So see here also, it is showing, see the lumen here and see the lumen here. In both of them, pollen grain or allergen or dust is entering. So dust is entering in a normal person, spasm is not taking place. Dust is entering in an asthmatic person, bronchospasm is taking place as a response. Give me a thumbs up, because these persons are hypersensitive. So three things, there are three symptoms of asthma, triad of asthma. Asthma patients have paroxysm. Paroxysm ka matlab hota hai attacks. Attacks of dyspnea, they can't breathe. They breathe like this. They have difficulty in breathing. Dyspnea, they have cough and they have wheezing. If you auscultate them, you will hear wheezing. So dyspnea, cough and wheezing. This is the triad of asthma. Never forget, never forget, never forget. Dyspnea, cough and wheezing. So these symptoms, the three symptoms, they come, they go. They come, they go. So that is, they are not permanent. They are relieved within few minutes. If they are not relieved in few minutes and asthma is permanent, the condition is known as status asthmaticus. It is an emergency. It is an emergency. So I will teach you treatment of normal asthma separately and treatment for status asthmaticus separately. Give me a thumbs up. Give me a thumbs up. Before coming on the classification of drugs for asthma, just in the 2 minutes, I will teach you the steps of asthma. Pathogenesis and the steps of steps and pathogenesis of asthma. Asthma is a type of type 1 hypersensitivity. You know, there are 5 type of hypersensitivity. It is an example of type 1. So what is happening? See here, as soon as, I will draw it for you. Okay. So as soon as this is the allergen, this is entering, this is the pollen grain. Just suppose it is entering inside my nose. It is entering inside my nose. It is going inside the trachea. It is going inside the bronchi. This pollen grain is going inside the trachea and inside the bronchi. So here, the lining of the trachea and the bronchi will take this allergen. And the first cell inside which this pollen grain will enter, the first cell, it is known as antigen presenting cell. So the name of this cell is APC, antigen presenting cell, also known as dendritic cell. Dendritic cell. So antigen presenting cell or dendritic cell will engulf the antigen. It will engulf the antigen. After engulfing the antigen, it will degrade the antigen into multiple pieces. It will process the antigen. It will degrade it. It will process it. And on the surface of this APC, MHC is present. Major histocompatibility complex, MHC. After degrading the antigen, the pieces of the antigen are presented on MHC. MHC. Can you see the green color is MHC? And APC, antigen presenting cell, will take this antigen to another cell. The name of another cell here is CD4 T cell. T cell. It is a T. There are two types of lymphocytes, B and T. It is CD4 T lymphocyte. CD4 T lymphocyte helper lymphocyte. TH2 type of helper lymphocyte. It will present it to this. It will get stimulated. It will secrete certain cytokines from it. IL-3, IL-4, IL-5. Multiple cytokines are secreted from it because of its stimulation. From these, the most important is IL-4. This IL-4 will go to third cell. The third cell here is B lymphocyte. B cell, B lymphocyte. So first cell is APC. Second cell is T lymphocyte. Then the third cell is B lymphocyte. Because of IL-4, this B lymphocyte will get stimulated. It will get converted into plasma cell. B cell will get converted into plasma cell. It will get stimulated, convert into plasma cell. Plasma cell will form antibodies. There are 5 type of antibodies. So here antibodies are formed. Here antibodies are formed. GAMDE, IgG, IgA, IgM, IgD, Ig, Gamre. Here IgE is formed. Gamre ka E banega. So IgE is formed. These IgE antibodies will go to another cell, the fourth cell. Fourth cell. This is mast cell. This is mast cell. So these IgE antibodies will go to mast cell and bind on the surface of the mast cell like this. And they will remain in the body forever like memory. They will remain there. The mast cell will be covered. This mast cell is known as sensitized mast cell. It is already sensitized. It contains antibody on it. Now this is the first time when this allergen is entering first time. This allergen is entering first time, then this is the scenario. The same allergen is entering second time. Or any subsequent time when this allergen will enter inside me. Mere andar ye sab hoke rakha hua hai already. Now when the same allergen is entering again body, as soon as it will reach here, the body will say, oh, we have identified you. We have memory for you. You are the one for which we have done the process completely previously only. So this process is not repeated again. So we will direct this antigen directly to the mast cell. This time this antigen will go to the mast cell directly. It will not go first to APC, then CD4 T cell, then B cell, then plasma cell, then mast cell. No. This time because of memory, the second time onwards, second, third, fourth, every time. Now the antigen directly go to the mast cell, bind on the surface of the antibody. Antibody antigen ke against hi bani hai na? That is specific antibody. It will bind with the antigen, antibody complexes are formed. Because of this complexes, the antibody will get stimulated. Antibody will send signals. Antibody will send signals to the mast cell. Mast cell will get stimulated. Mast cell will open calcium channels on the surface. The calcium channels will be opened and mast cell will burst. Degranulation. The granules inside the mast cell will come out. This is known as degranulation. degranulation of the muscle. It contains many things. What is the composition of granules? Now, granules contain histamine, it contains serotonin. The most important thing it contains is leukotriene. All these are secreted in blood. So histamine, serotonin, prostaglandin, leukotriene, everything is secreted in blood. So from blood, they will go, the leukotriene will go to the bronchi, trachea and bronchi. In the trachea and bronchi, the muscle, there are four layers, mucosa, submucosa, musculus propria and serosa. So the third layer, musculus propria, contains receptor for leukotriene. Please understand, if you want to understand the classification of the drug, leukotriene will bind to its receptor here and causes bronchoconstriction. Causes bronchoconstriction, that is attack of asthma. So patient is in attack. Have you got it? The complete process. Everyone give me a thumbs up. Everyone give me a thumbs up. So this is the whole thing shown in Robbins also. You can see an allergen here. This is the allergen. Please see, it is entering inside the human body. So, and it is taken by the first cell. The first cell here is dendritic cell. Dendritic cell will take it, degrade it, process it and present it on the surface with the help of MHC. After that, it will go to T cell. T cell may be CD4 T cell, CD8 name. CD4 may be helper type 2, TH2. Everything have one MCQ on it. So this is the second cell. It will get stimulated. It will secrete certain cytokines, IL-3, IL-4, IL-5. IL-4 will stimulate B cell. This is a B cell. B cell will get converted into plasma cell. This is a plasma cell. Plasma cell will form antibodies. Which antibody? IgE antibody. IgE antibody will go to mast cell. This is mast cell. It will bind here. Now the same allergen is entering again. It will directly bind to the antibodies present on the mast cell. Mast cell will be stimulated. It will burst and granules come out. Granules come out and this is like this. Everyone give me a thumbs up. Now you tell me. So a patient. So this granules contain leukotriene. Leukotriene kaha jayega? It will go to the trachea and bronchi and causes spasm there. Now how you can prevent the attacks of asthma at various places? Now it's very easy for you to understand the drugs if you have understood this. Everyone give me a thumbs up. Now during the first contact, an antigen is coming. It is taken by antigen presenting cell or dendritic cell. Dendritic cell or antigen presenting cell take it to TH2, CD4 helper type 2, type 1 nahi hai, helper type 2 cell. They will get stimulated. They will secrete IL-3, IL-4, IL-5. IL-4 go to the B cell. B cell will get converted into plasma cell. Plasma cell will form IgE antibody. IgE antibody will go to the mast cell. Mast cell are the main cells. These are known as sensitized mast cell. Now, during the second contact of the same antigen, it will directly go to the IgE antibodies present on the mast cell. Mast cell membrane will burst. Degranulation will take place. So you can see this is the antigen binding on the antibodies on the mast cell. So antibodies given the signal to the mast cell. So mast cell burst and can you see the granules are coming out? So granules are coming out. There are many things in the granules. You can see the composition of the granules. It contains many things. It contains histamine, serotonin, VIP, leukotrienes, prostaglandin, platelet activating factor. The most important is leukotriene P4 and D4. The receptors for leukotriene. So it contains leukotriene. Can you see? These are the granules. It contains leukotriene. It contains. So these leukotrienes are secreted in blood and from the blood, these leukotrienes, they are going in the trachea and bronchi and they are causing two things there. Bronchoconstriction and increased secretion from the glands. Can you see? This is the trachea. This is the wall of the trachea on which the receptors are present. These are leukotriene receptors. LT receptors. LT receptors are present. Leukotriene will come via blood from the mast cell. It is coming. From the mast cell, leukotriene is coming in the blood, binding with its receptor here. After binding, it is causing two things. Number one, bronchoconstriction. Can you see? It is leading to bronchoconstriction. It is leading to bronchoconstriction. And number two, increased secretion from the glands. Submucosa have glands. Increased. So, pehle lumen narrow ho gaya. Jo bacha pucha lumen hai thoda sa, it contains the secretion. So, complete occlusion. Complete occlusion. So, this is normal bronchi. First, it will undergo bronchoconstriction. So, lumen is narrowed. Whatever lumen is remaining, it is filled with the secretion. So two things are happening, bronchoconstriction and increased secretion from the gland. So patient is in attack of asthma. Patient will present with three things. Dyspnea, he can't breathe. He cough. He will try to take out the secretion so that lumen open. He will cough and patient will have wheezing. So dyspnea, cough and wheezing, these are the three things patient will present with. Give me a thumbs up, patient is in attack. Now tell me at what, now come on pharmacology. Okay. Come on, pharmacology. That was pathology part. Now you will understand pharmacology in a better way. Okay. So tell me the drugs for asthma. At what level you can prevent asthma and you can treat asthma? Listen. So this is the whole thing. Please understand this. Please first understand this. You tell me this thing, then I will tell you the drugs. Don't see on the drugs. See, this is the antigen. Everyone see, this is the antigen. It is entering inside. After entering inside, second time. This antigen is not first time. Second time antigen. So second time entry, he is going where? The antigen is going where? On entering second or subsequent time, not the first time. The antigen is directly going on the antibody, IgE antibody, which is present on the surface of the mast cell. This is the mast cell. This is the mast cell. So directly going on the antibody present on the mast cell. So mast cell will undergo degranulation. It will burst. Granules will come out. Especially leukotriene. Everything will come out, but most important is leukotriene. And leukotriene will cause bronchoconstriction. This bronchoconstriction is leading to attack of asthma. Give me a thumbs up. Now I am a doctor. There is a patient in front of me. There are two patients, patient A, patient B. Patient A is in attack of asthma. He can't breathe. He is dyspnea. He is in emergency. And he can't breathe. I want to cause bronchodilation in patient A. There is patient B in front of me. He said, I was having attack yesterday, doctor, but frequently I'm having attacks. Yesterday, in every 2-3 days, I'm having attack of asthma, but it is resolved spontaneously. But give me some drug so that I do not have attack ahead. So say, patient B wants prophylaxis. Patient A wants treatment. Patient B wants prophylaxis. So at what step I can do the prophylaxis and how I can do the treatment? So two things are there in asthma. Have you got it? Now listen, the drugs one by one. The first step, as soon as antigen is coming, it is binding to IgE antibody, no? IgE antibody. So if you give IgE antibody against antibody, you destroy this IgE antibody. Neutralize it. Antibody against antibody. So body mein IgE antibody hi nahi hogi. That will be already neutralized by your drug. Done. So if antigen is coming, it cannot bind with IgE antibody and the whole process will not take place. So the antibody against antibody. Antibody against IgE antibody. The drug is known as Omalizumab. Omalizumab is the drug. It is antibody against antibody. Against which antibody? IgE antibody. Antibody against IgE antibody. That is the first level of prevention. That is the first. It is not treatment. It is prevention. Then it is prevention. So if I neutral this is for patient B, I can offer Omalizumab to the patient. Okay, you take daily Omalizumab, your all IgE antibody will be neutralized. So if antigen will come in your contact, there will be no IgE antibody and the whole process start in a yoga. So you will not have attacks further. Done. That is the one thing. But it now there are two drawbacks. I cannot offer this very frequently. Very rarely I give this drug. There are two drawbacks. Number one, it comes in injection form. So daily patient have to take injection instead of a tablet. Patients do not prefer injections. They prefer oral route. Number one, and it is costly. Very costly. It is antibody. It is humanized antibody. No, it is very costly. So two drawbacks are there. That's why not used very frequently. And that is the thing. Okay, coming on the next step. If you can't neutralize antibody, so antigen will come. See, antigen will come. It will bind with the antibody. Antibody is present. It will bind. You have not neutralized it. So what next will happen? The mast cell will burst when antigen will come. It will bind with the antibody. Antibody will give signal to the mast cell. Mast cell mein calcium channels will open and mast cell will burst and degranulation takes place. So the second step you can do, you can give the treatment, the patient a tablet, which is mast cell stabilizer. So the membrane of the mast cell is stabilized. So when antigen is coming, binding with the IgE antibody, still mast cell is not rupturing. So mast cell will not rupture, leukotriene will not come out, bronchoconstriction will not take place. It comes in the form of tablets. There are three tablets, ketotifen, nidocromil and chromoglycolate. So these are chromoglycate. These are the three mast cell stabilizer. So the membrane of the mast cell will become stable. It will not open calcium channel and it will not burst even on antigen binding with the antibody. It will receive the signal, but it will not burst. Give me a thumbs up. That will work. Yes, it can work for patient B. I can give the prophylaxis. So I will ask the patient daily take a tablet of chromoglycate or these mast cell stabilizer. So all your mast cell in your blood, whatever mast cells are present, they will be stabilized. So even if you come in contact with your antigen, now your antigen can be dust, can be pollen. I don't know your antigen. So you don't know your antigen. Whenever you will come in contact, So your mast cells are stabilized. Don't worry, they will not burst. Leukotriene will not come out, and you do not have attacks. Yeah, number two. So that is the second step we can do. Number three, if we are not stabilizing mast cell, so ek step aur aage chalo. Ek step aur, we will go one step ahead. Okay, so we are not neutralizing. We are not neutralizing the antibody. We are not stabilizing the mast cell. What will happen? Antigen will enter. It will bind with the antibody. My antibody will get stimulated because you have not neutralized it. It will get stimulated. It will give the signal to the mast cell, and mast cell will burst. Because till now you have not stabilized mast cell also. It will burst. Degranulation will take place and leukotriene will come out. Leukotriene will come out. Have you got it? Leukotriene will come out. Leukotriene kahan se aa raha hai? Leukotriene aayega kahan se? Listen, this is a mast cell. The mast cell surface contains antibodies. These are IgE antibodies. These are IgE antibodies. These are IgE antibodies. As I have told you, there are granules inside the mast cell. These granules contain leukotriene. So when rupture takes place, when antigen comes and bind with these antibodies, the antigen will bind. It will give signal to the mast cell. Mast cell will open calcium channel. It will burst and leukotriene come out. Leukotriene synthesis kaise hota hai? How this leukotriene is synthesized inside the mast cell? So this is how leukotriene is synthesized inside mast cell. Just a second. Let me go behind and show you one thing. Okay, this is how. So you can see this is leukotriene. Can you see the various types of leukotriene? Leukotriene is synthesized from membrane of the mast cell. Membrane of the mast cell have an enzyme known as phospholipase A. So membrane phospholipid, the membrane of the mast cell converts phospholipid into arachidonic acid. And from arachidonic acid, these leukotrienes are formed by an enzyme known as LOX, that is lipooxygenase, LOX. There are two enzymes, COX and LOX. When COX acts on it, prostaglandins are formed. And when LOX act, leukotrienes are formed. So COX is for synthesis of prostaglandins. LOX is for synthesis of leukotrienes. So what you can give the patient, you give LOX inhibitor. LOX inhibitor. If my patient is taking a tablet of LOX inhibitor, so leukotrienes will not form inside the mast cell, because inside the mast cell LOX is inhibited. So membrane phospholipid will get converted into arachidonic acid, but LOX is not functioning. So LOX is not functioning, so leukotriene will not form, so bronchoconstriction will not take place. Have you got it? So LOX inhibitor, that is leukotriene synthesis inhibitor, I can give number one. There is one more drug, that is steroid. Steroids, you know, steroids inhibit phospholipase A. Steroids phospholipase ko inhibit kar dega. So arachidonic acid hi nahi banega. So LOX kya, COX kya? If you give steroids, that is corticosteroids, neither prostaglandins nor leukotrienes are formed. If you give LOX inhibitor, that is Xyluton. If you give Xyluton, Xyluton is LOX inhibitor, only leukotrienes is not formed. Have you got it? Okay, let me tell you again. This is membrane phospholipid. Membrane phospholipid get converted into arachidonic acid, and arachidonic acid se prostaglandins are formed and leukotrienes are formed. There are various enzymes. So here enzyme acting is phospholipase. Here phospholipase will convert membrane phospholipid into arachidonic acid. Here COX will act on arachidonic acid and convert into prostaglandin. Here LOX act on arachidonic acid and convert into leukotriene. The main culprit which cause bronchoconstriction is leukotriene. But prostaglandin also cause bronchoconstriction to a lesser extent. Dono karate hain, but zyada ye karata hai. So first thing, better is to inhibit phospholipase A2. If you inhibit phospholipase A2, neither arachidonic acid is formed, so neither prostaglandin will form nor leukotriene will form. So phospholipase inhibitor is corticosteroid. So you can give corticosteroids to the patient. But these are reserved drugs, Or you can give LOX inhibitor, that is Xyluton. You can give LOX inhibitor. So if you give corticosteroids, prostaglandin and leukotriene both will not be formed. If you give Xyluton, only leukotriene is not formed, prostaglandin still formed. Give me a thumbs up if you got it. So here is the drug. Everyone give me a thumbs up, whether I can see your chat or not. Yes, I can see. I can see what you are asking. Okay. So Ankita is saying, can you explain it again? Which thing, Ankita? Which thing should I explain again? Please write it. Please write it specifically. Okay. Let me come here. I'm sorry. Just a second. Okay. Where is the diagram? Yes. Okay. This one. So you can give leukotriene synthesis inhibitor. If you give corticosteroid, not only leukotriene, prostaglandin is also synthesis inhibitor is there. So prostaglandin, leukotriene, both synthesis inhibitor takes place if you give steroids. And if you give Xyluton, so Xyluton inhibits only LOX. and corticosteroids inhibit phospholipase. So in both scenarios, either we inhibit phospholipase or we inhibit LOX, leukotriene synthesis will not take place. Done. So we can do that. If leukotriene synthesis hoga hi nahi, so it will not cause bronchoconstriction. If you are not inhibiting this step also, so what will happen? Okay, so this is the trachea. These are the two bronchi and these are the lungs. And these are the walls of the trachea and bronchi, muscularis propria. Inside the muscularis propria, there are leukotriene receptors. These are the receptors of the leukotriene. And this is the blood vessel. This is the mast cell inside the blood vessel. Let me draw it. This is the mast cell. On the mast cell, this is the antibody. Let me draw a rough diagram to explain you, to explain the concepts clearly to you. Okay. So this is the antigen entering second time. When the antigen will bind to the surface of the mast cell, the antibodies on the mast cell, it will rupture. Once it will rupture, the leukotriene present inside it. You have not inhibiting the synthesis of leukotriene. So leukotriene is present. It will rupture. It will do degranulation. So leukotriene will come in blood. So via blood, it will go to the trachea and bronchi. It will bind to its receptor and causes bronchoconstriction. So here what you can do, you can give leukotriene receptor blockers. You just block the receptors of leukotriene with a drug. So when leukotriene is coming from the blood, it cannot bind with its receptor. So it will not cause bronchoconstriction. So these are not leukotriene receptors, leukotriene synthesis inhibitor. These are leukotriene receptor blocker. So what are the drugs? There are two drugs, Montelukast and Zephyrleukast. Montelukast. These are leukotriene receptor blocker, not synthesis inhibitor. Receptor blocker. Give me a thumbs up. Or ab tumne kuch bhi nahi kiya. You have not done anything. So this is the trachea. This is the bronchi. This is the wall of the trachea. This is the wall of the bronchi. These are the lungs. These are the receptors. Just a second. These are the receptors. Leukotriene receptor in the wall of the trachea and the bronchi. And this is the blood vessel. Let me draw it, huh? Once for all. This is a blood vessel. Inside the blood vessel, this is a mast cell. These are the antibodies on the mast cell. Tell me the whole story. At what step you can do the prevention? Prevention ke 5 steps batao. What are the 5 steps of prevention? Let me draw antigen. This is antigen. Antigen entered second time. Second time or subsequent time, not the first time. As soon as antigen will enter in the blood, it will go to the antibody. The antibody, IgE antibody, which is present on the mast cell. So this is IgE antibody, right? IgE antibody. So what you can do, you can give antibody against antibody. That is omalizumab. Done. If you have not done it, so antigen will bind to the antibody. It will stimulate mast cell and mast cell degranulation takes place and the leukotriene which is present inside the mast cell will come out. So second thing you can do here, you can give mast cell stabilizer. Mast cell stabilizer, there are 3 drugs, ketotifen, glycolate, chromium glycolate. There are 3 drugs. Done. So mast cell stabilizer. If you have not given mast cell stabilizer also, so leukotriene synthesis inhibitor. Give a drug which inhibit leukotriene ka synthesis. There are 2 drugs. Steroids which inhibit both prostaglandin also, leukotriene also by inhibiting an enzyme known as phospholipase. And LOX. LOX inhibitor. That is Zaluton. So that inhibits only LOX. That inhibits only leukotriene synthesis. Done. If you have not given leukotriene synthesis is inhibitor, so leukotriene will come out. After coming out, this leukotriene will go to its receptor. It will bind there and causes bronchoconstriction. So at the 4th step, what you can do, you can give leukotriene receptor blocker. The drug is Montelukast and Zephyrleukast. That will block the receptor. If you have not done it, you have not still done it, bronchoconstriction will take place. It is inevitable. So bronchoconstriction ultimately ho hi jayega. Now you cannot prevent it, you have to treat it. So last step is treatment. If bronchoconstriction occurs, you cannot prevent it now. Prevention ke ye sare steps hai. You can prevent it at first level, second level, third level, fourth level. There are 4 levels. You can prevent it. If you have not prevented at any of the step, bronchoconstriction already taken place, now you will treat it. So that is patient A now. It is not patient B. It is not preventing. We are not preventing now anymore. Bronchoconstriction already take place. So patient is already in attack. Now we have to treat it. Treatment ka sirf ek hi siddhant hai, bronchodilation. So give bronchodilator. Because patient is in bronchoconstriction, you have to give only 1 drug, bronchodilators. Bronchodilators. Give me a thumbs up. So in the whole pathophysiology, there are 5 categories. So at the first level, You can give antibody against IgE antibody. So the drug here is omalizumab. Or else you can give mast cell stabilizer. So antibody is bind to the mast cell. Mast cell ko stabilize kar do. Mast cell stabilizer. So mast cell stabilizer, there are three drugs. You already know the names, right? It is ketotifen, chromium glycolate, and one more is there, right? And then the third category, you can give leukotriene synthesis inhibitor or leukotriene receptor blocker. These two are different drugs. I have explained you very well, right? Synthesis ko inhibit karo. Synthesis ko inhibit karne ke bhi do tarike hain. Either inhibit leukotriene as well as prostaglandin synthesis both by giving steroids, corticosteroids, right? Or inhibit only leukotriene synthesis by inhibiting LOX enzyme. The drug is Zelutron. Done. These two are leukotriene synthesis inhibitor. Leukotriene receptor blocker, there are two drugs, montelukast and zafirlukast. So all these drugs are for prophylaxis. Prophylaxis for asthma. Give me a thumbs up. And if you have not done this, 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 or this, so ultimately what will happen? Bronchoconstriction will take place. So you have to do only one thing, that is bronchodilatation. Bronchodilatation ke liye there are three drugs, and that is used for treatment for asthma. Everyone give me a thumbs up. I really tried hard. So if you understand the pathogenesis of any disease now, understanding its drug is really fun for you, its treatment. Have you got it? Can you see here a beautiful diagram? Okay, what is the beauty in this diagram? See, okay, just a second. Okay, so can you see the lumen of the bronchi, of the trachea and the bronchi? Can you see the muscularis propria, the wall inside the muscularis propria? Can you see these are the leukotriene receptors? So when leukotriene is coming, binding with the leukotriene receptor, bronchoconstriction take place. Give me a thumbs up if you got it. Now what are the drugs? These are the drugs. So first category I have taught you is antibody against antibody, anti-IgE antibody. Antibody against antibody, anti-IgE khud hi ek antibody hai, uski against anti-IgE antibody, that is omalizumab, only one drug, omalizumab. After that, second category is mast cell stabilizer. So there are two main or three main, sodium chromoglycate and ketotifen. These are mast cell stabilizer. The third is leukotriene synthesis inhibitor. Here it is not given, so you can add a category here. Leukotriene synthesis inhibitor. वहाँ पे आपके आ जाएंगे एक तो steroids और दूसरा Zelutron. Steroids and Zelutron. Next is leukotriene receptor blockers. Fourth is, that is montelukast and zafirlukast. So these are the categories for prevention, prophylaxis. The four categories for prophylaxis. And main for treatment, only one category. For treatment, we have only one category, that is bronchodilators. But bronchodilators are of three types. It is beta 2 agonist, anticholinergic. Anticholinergic means it is M3 antagonist. M3, no? Yes, anticholinergic. It is M3 blockers. M3 antagonist. Beta 2 agonist. M3 antagonist or blockers, whatever you say. And methylxanthin. So three drugs. How they cause bronchodilatation, I will tell you. So what will be my sequence of teaching you? The most important for treatment is bronchodilators. So first I will teach you bronchodilators. Then I will teach you the four categories one by one for prophylaxis. Everyone give me a thumbs up. Everyone give me a thumbs up. Done. Ankita, why don't you take a live lecture on antidiabetic? Soon I will do that. Ankita, after completing this, I will do that. Okay. So have you got it? So first I am going to teach you bronchodilators. After that, I will teach you the drugs for prophylaxis. So drugs for treatment, drugs for prophylaxis. Drugs for treatment is only one bronchodilator. Let me start. The most important drug is bronchodilator. That is the only drug for treatment of a patient who is in attack. So any patient coming in asthma attack, you have to offer one of the bronchodilator. There are three types of bronchodilators. You can offer any one of them. There are pros and cons. There are benefits and side effects for each of them. So whatever is suitable to the patient, you can offer them. So all the asthma pumps, you know, there are pumps for asthma. They contain these bronchodilators. So bronchodilators are of three types. Beta 2 agonist, that is beta 2 sympathomimetic. Anticholinergic. There are three types of cholinergic receptors, na? M1, M2, M3. So these are M3 antagonist, M3 antagonist or M3 blockers. These are known as anticholinergic. And methylxanthins. So beta 2 agonist mein kya kya aa jayega? Beta 2 agonist contains salbutamol, terbutamil, bambutrol, salmeterol, formetrol. Methylxanthins mein theophylline, aminophylline, cholinethiophylline, hydroxyethylthiophylline, doxyphylline. So all phylline. Done. Anticholinergic, ipratropium, tiotropium. So these are the drugs that are used for bronchodilation, that is for treatment, not for prophylaxis. Done. These are the bronchodilators. So ultimately, what they all do the bronchodilatation of the trachea. Bronchodilatation. They will dilate it because the trachea and the bronchi are in spasm. We have to dilate it if we want to treat asthma, treat the attack. The patient is in attack of asthma right now. Patient is in front of me, patient is on a stretcher, patient can't breathe. I have to save the patient, otherwise patient will go in cyanosis and patient will die. I have to save my patient. So I will give one of the bronchodilator. Listen, for giving broncho, what is causing bronchoconstriction? Now listen how I explain you. Listen, this is the wall of the bronchi. There are four layers. Let me draw. Okay, let me see. Just give me 1 minute. Okay. Okay, so let me draw it, a simplified diagram for you. So this is the lumen of the trachea, this is the muscularis proprium, wall of the trachea. Done. When this wall can cause two things. Okay, let me draw in a simplified manner. It can undergo relaxation, so it will cause bronchodilatation, and it can undergo constriction. This wall can undergo constriction, so it will undergo bronchoconstriction. So there are certain things. Relaxation is caused by cyclic AMP. So any drug which increases the concentration of cyclic AMP will relax the wall. It will relax the wall and it will cause bronchodilatation. And the three things which causes bronchoconstriction, there are three things which causes bronchoconstriction. Number one, leukotriene. If leukotriene is going, it will cause bronchoconstriction. Number two, adenosine. Adenosine, it will go bronchoconstriction, and acetylcholine. Acetylcholine also cause bronchoconstriction. So any drug which inhibits these three, which decreases these three, antagonize these three, it will cause bronchodilatation. Ultimately in asthma, what I want? Bronchoconstriction and bronchodilatation. I want to treat asthma patient. There is a patient in front of me, he's in attack of asthma, he can't breathe. What I want? I will offer which drug? The drug which causes bronchoconstriction or the drug which causes bronchodilatation? Patient is already in constriction. I will give a drug which causes bronchodilatation. So I can offer treatment by two ways. Either I will give the drugs which increases cyclic AMP, so it will cause bronchodilatation, or I will give the drug which decreases leukotriene or inhibit leukotriene blocker, or adenosine blocker, or acetylcholine receptor blocker, that is M3 blocker. Give me a thumbs up, everyone. I'm trying hard, huh? So there are three. Have you got it? Now see this diagram. See, that is the same diagram I have drawn. So this is bronchial tone. You want relaxation or you want constriction? Relaxation is caused by only one thing, cyclic AMP. And contraction is caused by three things, leukotriene, adenosine, and acetylcholine. Have you got it? Now see the mechanism of action in a simplified manner in front of you. So beta, now this cyclic AMP, let me draw it again. So there is a bronchi, this is the lumen of the bronchi, and this is the wall of the bronchi. Now you can do two things. This is wall. This is the bronchial wall. You can relax the wall and you can constrict the wall. Once more, I have to draw it. Yes, I'm repeating it, but once more. Relax. If you relax it, there will be bronchodilatation. If you constrict it, there will be bronchoconstriction, right? Relaxation is caused by one thing, that is known as cyclic AMP. And constriction is caused by three things. What were the name? Adenosine, acetylcholine, and leukotriene. These three things are causing contraction. Listen. So my beta tone, now cyclic AMP is synthesized by cyclic AMP, I have told you, now cyclic AMP is synthesized by, synthesis is done by an enzyme. The name of the enzyme, I will tell you, the adenosyl cyclase is the name of the enzyme, and its destruction is caused by an enzyme known as phosphodiesterase. So you want more and more and more cyclic AMP, right? You want more cyclic AMP if you want to do bronchodilatation. So you have to increase this enzyme which causes more and more synthesis. And you have to decrease this enzyme which is causing its destruction. So if you decrease the enzyme or inhibit the enzyme which causes destruction, or if you stimulate the enzyme which causes its synthesis, so cyclic AMP will increase and it will relax and relax the wall and it will cause bronchodilatation. Right? Now listen to the drugs. The first drug is beta-2 agonist. Beta-2 agonist stimulates adenosyl cyclase. Beta-2 agonist. It stimulates adenosyl cyclase. Adenosyl cyclase causes synthesis of cyclic AMP. Cyclic AMP concentration will rise. It will relax the wall. It will cause bronchodilatation. Number one, beta-2 agonist. Number two drug, methylxanthine. Methylxanthine, theophylline or methylxanthine. That will cause that is phosphodiesterase inhibitor that will inhibit the enzyme phosphodiesterase. So destruction of cyclic AMP will not take place. So again, cyclic AMP concentration will increase because its destruction will not take place. Again, it will relax the bond. It will cause bronchodilation. So that is theophylline. Theophylline ke do mechanism hai. Ek to it is phosphodiesterase inhibitor. Dusra it is adenosine blocker. Adenosine blocker. So phosphodiesterase inhibitor and adenosine blocker. Adenosine ko block karega. So again, constriction nahi hoga, relaxation hoga. Done. That is the mechanism of action of theophylline. So beta 2 agonist ka reception mechanism of action ho gaya. Theophylline ka mechanism of action ho gaya. The third, anticholinergics. Anticholinergics inhibit acetylcholine M3 receptors. So acetylcholine receptors are inhibited. Again, bronchoconstriction nahi hoga, bronchodilatation hoga. Have you got it? Sabka mechanism is chote se diagram mein. This diagram contains mechanism of action of all drugs. Done. Let me mark the drugs for you people. I hope you understand. Beta 2 agonist. Theophylline ke two functions are there. Theophylline ke. And muscarinic antagonist se mera matlab hai. It is anticholinergics. Anticholinergics. See, beta 2 agonist, what they are doing? They are stimulating an enzyme adenyl cyclase. So cyclic AMP will increase, it will cause relaxation. Theophylline is doing two things. It is inhibiting, see minus, inhibiting an enzyme phosphodiesterase. So it is again decreasing the destruction. Decreasing the destruction of cyclic AMP, so increasing the concentration of cyclic AMP. So both these drugs are increasing the concentration of cyclic AMP, one by increasing its synthesis, one by decreasing its destruction. Ultimately, cyclic AMP will increase and it will cause relaxation. Theophylline doing one more thing. It is inhibiting adenosine. Adenosine ka inhibitor. Done. And anticholinergics. Anticholinergics here. Anticholinergics are inhibiting M3 receptors for the acetylcholine. They are inhibiting acetylcholine. Everyone give me a thumbs up. Everyone. So the same diagram here also. You can see we want to increase cyclic AMP. If we want to convert constriction into relaxation. In asthma, patient is in contraction. Bronchocontraction. Patient is in asthma. We want to convert contraction into relaxation. So we have to increase cyclic AMP. For increasing cyclic AMP, we have to stimulate the enzyme which causes its synthesis and inhibit the enzyme which causes its destruction. So we have to stimulate adenyl cyclase, which is done by beta 2 agonist, and we have to inhibit the enzyme phosphodiesterase inhibitor, which is done by theophylline. Everyone give me a thumbs up. I tried hard. So that is the mechanism of action of these three drugs. One by one, I will take it. I have already explained you the mechanism of action of these three. These three are bronchodilators. Now you know the mechanism of action of each of them, right? Yes or no? So beta 2 agonist, you already know. Beta 2 agonist, they stimulate adenyl cyclase. Methylxanthin, they inhibit phosphodiesterase inhibitor and they inhibit adenosine receptor. Anticholinergics, they inhibit acetylcholine receptors, that is M3 receptor, M3 antagonist. So that is the, in short, mechanism of action of each of them. If you know mechanism of action of each of them, you can crack any MCQ. So that is how we give treatment to the patient. Done. So I will take them one by one. I request you to make a comparative table between the three. So beta 2 agonist first I will teach you. Then I will teach you methylxanthin, that is theophylline. Then I will teach you anticholinergics. Anticholinergics, you can write M3 antagonist, whatever, one and the same thing. So in each of them, write the drugs for each of them, classification in each of them, and mechanism of action for each of them, adverse effect for each of them. Use the same asthma. All of them are used in asthma, right? Bronchodilator in the treatment of asthma, not in prophylaxis. Done. So beta 2 agonist. I'm starting with the first category. Tell me the classification. Beta 2 agonist ka classification. Now beta 2 agonist and anticholinergic. Both of them are 2-2 types. Short acting, long acting, short acting, long acting. Short acting and long acting. Listen, short acting, long acting. Short acting are for immediate treatment. Long acting can be given for prophylaxis. Can be given. Long acting, hai na, they will act after 6-8 hours. So if the patient will take it, agle 6-8 hours attack nahi aayega. That is for prophylaxis. But short acting will act within few minutes. So patient is in attack. In the pump, he will take short acting beta 2 agonist. So he will have immediate bronchodilation and attack will be relieved. So you have to learn the names. Short acting is salbutamol hai. Long acting is salmeterol. Please, very important MCQ. Very important. Salbutamol short hai, salmeterol long hai. Terbutalin and others also you read it. Either formeterol, others also you read by yourself. Most important was salmeterol and salbutamol. And you can read all other names also. That is beta 2 agonist classification. Short acting for acute attack and long acting for prophylaxis. Short acting acts within 5 minutes. As soon as patient will apply the pump, Within 5 minutes, bronchodilation will take place, attack will be gone. Done. Long acting will act after 12 hours. After 12 hours. So that is for prophylaxis. Give me a thumbs up. Mechanism of action, you already know. They stimulate an enzyme known as adenylate cyclase. So this enzyme increases the synthesis of cyclic AMP. So cyclic AMP concentration will increase and it will cause relaxation of the muscle. So it will cause bronchodilation. You know the mechanism of action. Done. So it is stimulating an enzyme adenylate cyclase. So cyclic AMP will increase. Cyclic AMP convert bronchocontraction into bronchodilation. Have you got it? So cyclic AMP increase karega by stimulating adenylate cyclase. Yeah, there are two types of airways. This is larger airways, you know, trachea, bronchi, and bronchioles are smaller airways, primary, secondary, tertiary. So it will cause bronchodilation of all larger airways also, smaller airways also, but mainly it acts at smaller airways. It mainly acts as smaller, the red dots. Can you see? Not purple one, the red one. Can you see here? The red one. That is that they mainly cause bronchodilation of small airways, not of large. Again, a very important MCQ. I will teach you anticholinergics also, M3 antagonists are also bronchodilators, but mainly of large airways. So both of them are bronchodilators. Which two? Beta 2 agonist and M3 antagonist. Both of them causes bronchodilation, but which airways? So beta 2 agonist causes bronchodilation of smaller airways, and M3 antagonist or anticholinergics causes bronchodilation of larger airways. Again, a very important MCQ. Done. Adverse effect beta agonist ke batane ki zarurat hai kya? Beta agonist, you know na, adverse effect. In ANS, you already know these adverse effects. So, you know, whenever any beta 2 agonist we take, so tachycardia, palpitation, arrhythmia, tremors, spasms, muscle cramps, so hyperglycemia, diabetes. So these are the side effects, tolerance. These are the side effects. We already know the side effects of beta agonist. So these are the side effects of beta agonist. So no need to learn. You already know. What is the route? By what route you will give a beta 2 agonist? By what route you will give? You will not give it oral. You will not give subcutaneous injection. You will not give any IM injection. You will give inhalational route. So inhalational route se hi dena padega. So inhalational route ke liye there are pumps. These are known as inhalers. Meter dose inhalers, MDI, meter dose inhalers. Have you seen a pump or inhaler of an asthmatic patient in your relatives or your family or any neighbor or any patient using this pump? You must have seen what is the composition of the pump, what are the parts of the pump. So it is given by inhalational therapy, by inhalational route. These are the fastest acting. It is an emergency now. So inside it, drug is present in the form of the particles. So size of particles should be between 1 to 5 picometer. The size of the drug inside the pump should be 1 to 5. It is less than 1, it will not go inside. If it is more than 5, more than 10, if it is less than 1, you will inhale and again exhale it. And if it is more than 5, it will go and get deposited in the mouth only, it will not go ahead. So that's why this is the ideal size. For delivery, there are three instruments we are having. Number one, meter dose inhaler, most commonly used. Number two, nebulizer, and number three, Rotacaps. I will explain you all three one by one. Let me take MDI, meter dose inhalers. Can you see? This is the diagram. This is how patient uses it. These are the steps the patient uses it. You know it is very easy. Inside this, the drug is present in micronized form. The size of the drug is 1 to 5 picometer inside it. So drug is present inside it here in the canister. This is a canister. It contains the drug. It is a refill. We can do the refill of the canister. Done. And hand breathing coordination is required. What do you mean by hand breathing coordination? The instant the patient is doing inhalation, at the same instant he should press the button so that drug will go inside. So hand breathing coordination, we have to teach the patient how it has to be done. So what are the steps? So ask the patient to remove the cap. There is a cap, the cap mouthpiece, the cap is removed. Shake the inhaler. After that, exhale out as much as you can. So breathe out, exhale out as much as you can. Then put the mouthpiece here, breathe in and press down the inhaler. At the same moment you are pressing the button, at the same moment you are starting breathing in. So this is hand mouth coordination is required. Then you breathe it for how many puffs? Doctor will tell you 1 puff, 2 puffs. There are puffs, huh? 1 puff, 2 puffs. So just do the puffs according to the dose, depending on the severity. Do the puffs, 1, 2, 3, whatever, and you just inhale it. After inhale it, hold the breath for 10 seconds. breathe, hold for 10 seconds. Don't exhale out. After that, breathe out. After that, breathe out. So these are the steps. These are the steps. Have you got it? When you are pressing the button, at the same moment, you have to do the inhalation. So inhalation, where the drug will go? First, it will go in the mouth. It will go in mouth. From mouth, it will go to the pharynx. From pharynx, it will go to the larynx. From larynx, it will go to the trachea and bronchi. So it requires a propellant. You know propellant? Propellant is something that will take the drug along with it till trachea. Otherwise, when you pump, drug will be deposited in the mouth only. It will not go ahead if you give it without propellant. So what is propellant we are using? Initially, we were using CFC. I'm really sorry. Initially, we were using CFC, chlorofluorocarbons. But it is not environmental friendly. It is an environmental pollutant. It is causing ozone layer depletion and global warming. You know, so that's why we are not using it nowadays. Nowadays, we are using hydrofluoroalkanes. So these are the propellant we are using. This is not a drug. This is a carrier of the drug that will take the drug from mouth till trachea. You can say this is a carrier. It is a propellant. So along with the drugs, we use propellant. Have you got it? So iske andar do cheeze hain. It contains drug also. It contains propellant also. This is the mouthpiece. This is meter. You have to set the drug inside it. Kitna tumhe drug lena hai? You have to set in the meter and you have to push the button. So it contains propellant with the drug. Two things are there. Give me a thumbs up. Everyone give me a thumbs up. The first thing was MDI. Second thing is nebulizer. What is nebulizer? Now there is a patient, this is a patient I can teach, this is an adult. If the patient is child, if the patient is psychiatric, I cannot teach the patient this step. Hand breathing coordination. So I cannot teach the patient whenever the instant you are pressing the button, at the same instant you have to inhale it. This is a training. So you cannot train it to psychotic patient or a very sick patient or child. You cannot train it. In them, use nebulizer. In nebulizer, no coordination is required. Hand breathing coordination is not required. Machine automatically, this machine contains the drug inside it. It automatically will give the drug when the patient is inhaling. Jab inhalation ho raha hai, drug apne aap andar chal raha hai. Patient do not have to do coordination. So in nebulizer, we have already seen in COVID time, what is nebulizer and what are the parts of, I hope you already know the parts of the nebulizer, right? So minimum coordination is required. For very severely ill patient, we use it. But here, the drawback, it large amount of drug is required and it is costly as compared to pumps. And it takes time. It takes time for bronchodilation. That is nebulizer. So we are done with MDI. We are done with the nebulizer. The third is RotaCap. What is RotaCap? It is a capsule. It is a capsule. RotaCap. Cap is a capsule. So it is a capsule-like thing. You see, these are the capsules. Okay. See, these are the capsules. So take one capsule and there is a crusher. Capsule crusher. You know, these are the capsules and this is the crusher for the capsule. It comes along with it. So put your capsule inside the crusher. It doesn't contain any propellant. Put the mouthpiece inside your mouth and just press it, crush it. So the RotaCap, that is the capsule containing the drug, is punctured. It is crushed, it is punctured, and the powder drug is present in powdered form. So powder is aerosolized and patient have to inhale very deeply. A deep inhalation is required. It is environmental friendly because no propellant is there. Minimum coordination is required, but patient should have sufficient inspiratory rate. Door se inspire karna padega kyunki propellant nahi hai. To andar tak le jani hai, muh mein nahi chhodna hai. Andar tak jana chahiye. It should be minimum 60 liters per minute. So those patients who have inspiratory rate of 60 liters per minute, so instead of MDI, you can offer RotaCaps also. They are very cheap. Give me a thumbs up if you got it. Everyone give me a thumbs up. Everyone. Now, the beta 2 agonists are the drugs of choice for acute attack of asthma. As I have told you, I have to teach you bronchodilators. Bronchodilators are the only drugs for treatment of acute attack of asthma. Rest, all the drugs are for prophylaxis for asthma. The four categories, 1, 2, 3, 4. These are prophylaxis, not treatment. Treatment ke liye ek hi drug hai, bronchodilator. Bronchodilator bhi teen tarah ke hain. There are three types of bronchodilators, as I have told you. Beta 2 agonist, methyl xanthin, anticholinergic. Among them, beta 2 agonists are drug of choice for acute attack. Otherwise, if otherwise not contraindicated. So any patient coming to me having an acute attack of asthma, if not otherwise contraindicated for beta 2 agonist, I will offer beta 2 agonist in the form of the inhalers. Inhalers is the best route I can give. Done. So I will give short acting beta 2 agonist to treat the acute attack of asthma. Coming on methyl xanthan. The second category is methyl xanthan. Methyl xanthan, these are the drugs. You know all phylene, 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 phylene. So most important is theophylline. What is the mechanism of action? There are two mechanisms, as I have told you. Number one, they inhibit phosphodiesterase inhibitor enzyme. Phosphodiesterase inhibitor enzyme ko inhibit karega. So phosphodiesterase inhibit enzyme was causing destruction of cyclic AMP. Now since the enzyme is inhibited, so destruction of cyclic AMP will not take place. So concentration of cyclic AMP will increase. So it is also increasing concentration of cyclic AMP not by increasing its synthesis like beta 2 agonist. It is causing decrease in destruction. किसी भी चीज को बढ़ाने के दो तरीके हैं. अगर मैं किसी चीज को बढ़ाना चाहती हूँ तो दो तरीके हैं. या तो मैं उसका सिंथेसिस बढ़ा दूं या तो मैं उसका डिस्ट्रक्शन कम कर दूं. सो द सेम वे इफ आई वॉन्ट टू इंक्रीज साइक्लिक एएमपी कॉजेज ब्रोंकोडायलेटेशन. आई वॉन्ट टू इंक्रीज इट. सो बीटा टू एगोनिस्ट आर इंक्रीजिंग इट्स सिंथेसिस एंड बाय स्टिमुलेटिंग द एंजाइम एडिनाइल साइक्लेज एंड द मिथाइल ज़ैंथेन्स are decreasing its destruction by inhibiting the enzyme phosphodiesterase. So they are phosphodiesterase inhibitors. Have you got it? So phosphodiesterase ko inhibit kar doge aap, to cyclic AMP ka destruction nahi hoga. Cyclic AMP will not convert into 5 AMP. No, it will not convert. So its concentration will increase and it will cause bronchodilation. Give me a thumbs up. That is the first mechanism. Second mechanism, it inhibit adenosine. Can you see here? Adenosine receptor. So theophylline inhibit adenosine receptor also. Adenosine was causing bronchoconstriction. So if adenosine is inhibited, bronchoconstriction will not take place and again bronchodilation will take place. So two mechanism of action: blockage of adenosine receptor and inhibition of phosphodiesterase inhibitor. So two mechanisms. Both of them are shown here. Theophylline. Theophylline inhibiting phosphodiesterase inhibitor mechanism number one. And inhibiting adenosine receptor mechanism number two. So two mechanisms are there. Give me a thumbs up. Everyone give me a thumbs up. So that is the mechanism of action of theophylline on lungs. What is the dose? Here dose is really very important. This is having a very narrow therapeutic window. That's why 5 to 20 microgram is the ideal dose. You know? Okay. My time is over for this lecture. So I have to stop here. Just a second. Let me announce my next lecture. I will continue it. Don't worry. My next lecture is just after 10 minutes now. So that's why I have to stop here timely. I cannot extend it. So thank you very much for being with me. I really enjoyed teaching you. Thank you. We will continue pharmacology. Don't worry. And don't forget to give your feedbacks in the chat box right now. My next class is just after 10 minutes. Just after 10 minutes at 11:30 a.m. sharp. Have a cup of coffee. Come back. We will study pathology in the next class. In the pathology, I am starting today's systemic pathology. Don't dare to miss it. I am starting with CVS. So join that link. That it is on special class, not on YouTube. It is free. It is on special class. So go to Unacademy Learners app, install that, go to the special class and you will find a link there after 10 minutes, right? For detailed lecture and attending my lecture on special class, install Unacademy Learners app from the Play Store. Go to the Neet PG category. Search my name there, Dr. Priyanka Sachdev. You will find my name, my profile link. Follow my profile link for getting a list of lectures there. You can see or any lecture free of cost. The free one are available, not the plus one. Free one you can see free of cost. But yeah, you will require a code. The code is Sachdev, S-A-C-H-D-E-V, Sachdev 10. That is my surname. Please distribute this code to everyone. Done. On the paid platform, we have two things. What are two types of paid platform? Plus subscription, Iconic subscription. In plus subscription, you will get access to both live and recorded lectures. In Iconic, you will get access along with Unacademy. You will get prep letter also. So if you are thinking of taking a plus subscription, better to go with Iconic because you will get advantage of both at a very less increase in price, right? In a paid platform, in plus and Iconic, we have a highly effective and updated question bank containing more than 25,000 clinical based image based question. So for all exams, NEET, PG, INI, CT, FMG, NEXT, all exam questions are covered here. New questions, repeat ones, everything. So if you do these 25,000 question practice now, your selection is guaranteed. I can challenge. So take the advantage of this if you take the subscription. I want your photograph next to be here, right? These are the batches available on paid platform. Batch for NEXT, batch for FMG, batch for INI, CT, batch for clinical examination. So you can take the advantage of all these batches if you take the subscription. Last two offers for you. If you take a subscription for 24 months, you will get 4 months additional. If you take a subscription for 12 months, you will get 2 months additional. Done. These are the various plans in Iconic, and these are the various plans in Plus. In Plus, minimum is 1 month, maximum is 4 year. In Iconic, minimum is 12 months, maximum is 4 year. Done. Longer the subscription, cheaper it is. So most cheapest is the 4 year subscription. So if you are a first year, second year, third year student, take longer subscription. 4 year, 3 year, 2 year, depending on your convenience. If you are an intern now, you can take 1 month, 3 month, 6 month also. So depending on your convenience, whatever subscription you want to take, take it. And you know, prices are very nominal. Whatever subscription you are taking, still on these price also, you will get further discount if you apply my code. My code is SACHDEV10. If you apply before payment, you will get further discount. So the summary is that the code is useful for all students. SACHDEV10. It is useful for all students. Those who want to watch free classes only, not the paid one. And those who want to take paid subscription also. Those who want to free classes, they can use this code for unlocking the free class. And those who want to take the paid subscription Plus or Iconic, they can use this code for getting heavy discounts before payment. So minimum 10% discount will be given. Done. So SACHDEV10 is the code. Please help me in distributing this code to all the medicos you know all over the world. Your friends, your juniors, your seniors, if you yourself want to take the advantage, anyone can, is open to take the advantage of this code. Please distribute it to everyone without any hesitation for free classes unlocking and for paid classes also. So please put it on your batch group. See you all just after 5 minutes at 11:30 sharp. Just after 5 minutes, we will study pathology where? Not at YouTube. Please come on the special class of Unacademy Learners app.